Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good afternoon. Let's let people get to their seats. And let me welcome people to the Council on Foreign Relations. I'm Richard Haass. And let me just make clear for the record, because it's been known on occasion that our distinguished visitors are sometimes somewhat tardy. And though our most distinguished visitor today was somewhat tardy, I want to make it clear for the record, on the record, that the responsibility was not his. Traffic in New York today is considerable because of the visit of the president to a firehouse, to Ground Zero, and so forth. So I just wanted to make that clear.
I agree.
It's a real personal pleasure for me to welcome the Taoiseach, Enda Kenny, to the Council on Foreign Relations. He has been Prime Minister for all of 2 months. I think your two-month anniversary is next week. It's a little bit like dog years or whatever. It just feels seven times longer. But your timing is interesting. Obviously, the news of the country and the world has been focused on the death of Osama bin Laden. As I just mentioned, the president is here today. The United States is now in the final 2 or 3 months of an extraordinarily significant budget debate about our debt ceiling. We're also coming up on July 1, which is the date the president said that reductions of American forces in Afghanistan would begin. So what I take from this, it's important to draw lessons from experience, is that if you want a slow week, do not invite the Irish Prime Minister. The reason I say this is a personal pleasure is not simply that we had the chance to get to know each other a few weeks ago in Dublin, but I spent 3 years being the U.S. envoy to the Northern Ireland peace process. And what it did, among other things, is it took me to London, Dublin, and Belfast 4 or 5 times a year, and a chance just to meet with a wide range of people. It's the only thing I've ever been associated with in my career that had the semblance of success associated with it. Otherwise, my career has been truly unblemished by success. It's also the only time I've ever been in a situation where on the streets of a city, in this case Dublin, people would come up to me, and if they recognized me for whatever reason, it doesn't happen frequently, they would say thank you, which was extraordinary. There was a real sense of caring and concern on the part of the people, and were would always wish me well, and then when there were some signs of progress, were extraordinarily grateful. And one of the real pleasures of the job, and it's not always the case in diplomacy, was actually working with my counterparts, including who's now Michael Collins, who's now Ireland's ambassador here in the United States. It really was a team effort led by the Irish government, the British government, the United States was quite, we were in a support role, but again, a lot of good came of it. Prime Minister inherited a situation which is extraordinarily challenging. We'll talk about it for a few minutes, then we'll open up to you, our members. People please turn off their cell phones. A bit of housekeeping, that would be great. Today's meeting is on the record, as those cameras suggest, so anything you say, as the police inform defendants, anything you say can and will be used against you. And again, I really do want to thank you for taking the time on this visit to the United States to be with us here at the Council on Foreign Relations. I want to go back 10 years, and the reason with Osama bin Laden in the news, I was in Dublin meeting with not your predecessor, but the predecessor of your predecessor when the news came in about the planes hitting the tower. Indeed, I watched the second plane hit the tower in the office of the Taoiseach at the time. We then went out and did a rather impromptu news conference, and I couldn't get back to the United States, so I spent that night in Dublin. First in Dublin, then I went to Belfast. And it was rather remarkable to be spending that night in a city that for a lot of Americans, the word Belfast was associated with the word terrorism, obviously on a fundamentally different scale, in the sense as many people died on 9/11 as essentially died during the Troubles. But it also formed a fascinating and, ironically enough, useful backdrop to diplomacy, because what 9/11 did was mark the end of any tolerance whatsoever for the use of violence to promote political ends. And it actually gave me, as the U.S. envoy, ironically enough, something to work with. I'd just be curious to begin with, before we get to some of the economic questions and the rest, what was the reaction in your country? What was your own reaction to the events of the last couple of days? And what, if any, difference do you think it might make heading forward?
First of all, can I say that Richard Haass played a significant part in the jigsaw of putting together a permanent peace process in Ireland. I want to recognise that here. And this very day, people in Northern Ireland are actually going to the polls voting for the election of an assembly. And this assembly has been the first in a very long period of years that has run its course without any real difficulty. And you, sir, put your thumbprint on part of that picture. Because of the difficulties that we have encountered in Northern Ireland over 30 years, we've got some understanding of what terrorist activities are about, how they impact on people's lives, how the memory of loss is seared on people's minds. From that perspective, all governments in our country supported the peace process. And whether we were in opposition or in government, all played their part in standing on the one platform, which eventually became the Good Friday Agreement, where people north and south voted by referendum for that agreement, which is an international treaty. And except for a few tragic incidents, by and large, life has continued with a degree of normality. And Richard Haass played his part in the development of that, and I just want to acknowledge it. In respect of what happened in Pakistan, I think this was inevitable at some point or other. The world has moved on significantly in the last number of years. I think there's really a need for an understanding of the cultures that you have to deal with in the Middle East and beyond. Not the same as dealing with countries that you know very well. And whether it be Tunisia or Egypt or the Yemen or Syria or Saudi or Libya and right across through to Iran, Iraq, Pakistan, Kashmir, Afghanistan and India, all of these have significant problems and significant difficulties with each other. I think that the fact that Osama bin Laden has been removed as the head of Al-Qaeda brings a closure in a way to that particular part of the terrorist process, but it doesn't put an end to it and won't put an end to it. And while Al-Qaeda as a terrorist organisation may not be in the forefront of terrorist activities for the past period, it doesn't mean that there shouldn't be continued very extensive vigilance as to what the consequences might be. By that I mean that there are people in Pakistan, obviously, who would be supportive of the Al-Qaeda organization. There are difficulties between Pakistan and India, leaving aside the question of Kashmir, which is very intractable. There is a difficulty of the United States dealing with the Taliban, the fragility that exists in Afghanistan, and these are problems that are not going to be sorted out overnight. So I think that the fact that Osama bin Laden's been removed brings a closure, in a sense, to that particular element of terrorist activity. But as we know only too well, it doesn't restrict and won't stop other organisations or other elements of terrorist activities continuing. And I'm quite sure that that's a matter of significant importance to the United States and to the President. I was in the White House and had the privilege to be there on St. Patrick's Day, met President Obama, and he announced on that occasion that he's coming to Ireland. My first duty in coming here last evening was to stand on the viewing platform at Ground Zero and see the site in its current state as it's being developed with the buildings and the monument. There were 12 Irish people working in the trade towers, and many more associated with the Port Authority police and the firemen and so on. I actually remember, Richard, reading an account by a British journalist who described the scene afterwards in the towers before they collapsed. And I remember his line writing about the courage on the faces of the young men not coming down, but going up. So the fact that the American forces have taken out Osama bin Laden will bring fresh memories of loss to people in Bali and in Madrid and in London and in New York. And I think it also brings about a recognition that countries that harbour terrorists and harbour terrorist activities and terrorist organisations have to understand that there are responsibilities and consequences, as these things can't be allowed to fester. Human life, and innocent human life, should not be taken out in that kind of fashion. They're my views, really.
Thank you. Before we get to the economics, let me just ask you, you mentioned the Assembly elections day in Northern Ireland. Just quickly on that subject, is it your sense that no matter what else happens in Northern Ireland, it can't go back to the way it was? That
yes.
Those days are essentially over.
Yes.
And then if that's the case going forward, what's your sense then of the relationship between the Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland? Obviously, it's part of the political agenda of certain groups. Where does all that stand?
Well, Richard, there's no going back. We had a very tragic incident in the last 6 to 8 weeks of a bomb placed under a car of a young police officer working for the Northern Ireland Police, which are known as the PSNI, the Police Service of Northern Ireland. And he was a young Catholic in his early 20s. He was a supporter of the Gaelic Athletic Association, played football with the Gaelic Athletic Association, was a Catholic and joined the PSNI to contribute to his community. A bomb was placed under his car by an offshoot of the original provisional IRA with a name attached to it of republicanism. I attended the funeral myself. It was the first time that an Irish Taoiseach actually attended at the funeral of a police officer. It was the first time that Peter Robinson, the leader of the DUP and the First Minister of the Assembly, ever attended in a Catholic church.
He was Protestant, by the way.
And equally so, it was the first time that Martin McGuinness, former member of the IRA and the Deputy First Minister in the Assembly, attended at the funeral of any police officer as well. But even more symbolic was the power of the symbolism here. Because 10 years ago, the Gaelic Athletic Association prohibited its members from being associated with the PSNI and vice versa. If you were a member of the police organisation, you could not become a member of the Gaelic Athletic Association. And yet on that street, in that small village, the players of the Gaelic Athletic Association carried the remains in the coffin and handed them over to the police service, who in turn handed the remains over to the family for bringing into the church for the mass. And the same happened in reverse on the way back out. And two statements were very important. The secretary of the sporting organisation for Ulster, which is a national organisation, said, if you touch one of us, you touch the entire country, which is true. And secondly, his mother, the mother of the young man who was murdered, said, I just want to say that this tragic happening should not prevent any other young Catholic from wanting to join the PSNI. If a young man or young woman feels that that is their career and that they can make a contribution to peace in their community and protection of citizens from those who disrupt law and order, then that should not prevent them. The people who really suffered here were those who espouse violence in the name of some warped form of republicanism. So there's no going back. Now, the relationship between the Republic, the government of which I lead, and the Assembly and the members of that Assembly in Northern Ireland is a very strong relationship. And indeed, that was there in the previous government's time and in the government before that. So, as I say, all governments over the last 25 years have supported the peace process. But what we're trying to do is to develop an all-island economy. As you know, it's a very small island, northeast and the other 26 counties. So it's to build an economic island where tourism, for instance, if you land on the shores of Ireland, you are a visitor to the island. For those of you who swing at the small white ball on the first tee, we have the home of champions in young McIlroy and McGrain and McDowell and Harrington, all these winners of the US Open and the US PGA, almost won the Masters, the British Open. So if you feel like a vacation and you want good golf links, please come to our little green island in the northwestern part of Europe. So from that point of view, we cooperate very much with the Northern Ireland Assembly and indeed with the British government. In fact, the Irish government is putting in considerable financial contributions for the development of roads, the development of hospitals, shared medical services, strong interest in trade and business, and educational circles and so on. So in that sense, there's a very good harmony between the two communities. We have always supported and appreciated the International Fund for Ireland funds from the United States, which former Ambassador Foley would have been involved in as well, which were used for deprived and vulnerable areas, particularly in Northern Ireland, where you didn't want young men in particular to regress and go back to ways of violence. So we support that and have always done so. We get other assistance from the European Union. So there's no going back, Richard. The way forward here is onwards and upwards. It's always a challenge to keep young men in particular challenged and occupied and pointing the way towards, you know, a peaceful way for the future. And that's a constant challenge. So we look forward as a new government. Early in June, actually, we're going to have a North-South Ministerial Council. That is where the ministers of my own government, with the members of the newly elected Assembly, will come together and discuss those cross-border issues, cross-community issues, and how we can assist in a developmental programme that will assist both communities. So that's all very hopeful and optimistic for the future.
As tempted as I am, as sorely tempted as I am, to follow up your comment about the small white ball on the little wooden object, I will resist temptation.
Well, I challenge your president, and I don't think he's...
The president of this organization will accept your challenge. not to worry. You're on. So let's turn to economics for a minute, from the sublime to something. It was several months ago that your government accepted, if my numbers are right, an $85 billion euro rescue package put together by a number of parties led by the EU, the ECB, and IMF. And I understand that your government is pursuing all sorts of measures to bring the deficits down. I think the goal is, what, 3% of GDP by 2015, give or take?
Right.
We're obviously having debates here. What is your formula for doing that? What is your... you're thinking in terms of budget cuts as opposed to taxes. What is your approach? The British government has one model of doing it, a lot of front-loading of spending cuts, a 3-to-1 ratio of spending cuts to tax increases. Here we haven't decided on all that. Where have you come out?
Well, where I've come from is that we're now in government almost 2 months. No government in the history of our country has ever faced the scale of the economic challenge that the government I lead faces. In fact, it's very much like what happened in the early part of the last century, in the 1920s. The first government of our state actually built a new country out of the rubble of the old. We've got to build a new economy out of the rubble, or certainly considerable elements of rubble, of an economy that was destroyed by reckless spending, reckless lending, and gross incompetence in a whole range of areas. That means that we are unable to borrow money ourselves. Our banks have been unable to borrow money, and this has been continued now for over 2.5 years. So we had arriving on our shores visitors from the IMF and the ECB and the EU. And so this troika effectively control much of the running of the financial elements of our country at the moment. So our target's to be able to say goodbye to them in due course, go back to the international bond markets, borrow ourselves at lower interest rates, and be in charge again of our own economic destiny. In order to do that, the government I lead has been given the strongest mandate in the history of the state. In the recent general election, the party that I lead, the Fine Gael Party, together with the Labour Party, achieved a unique overall majority. So we've got a very strong mandate. What does that mean? It means stability politically. It means the opportunity to bring certainty where there was confusion. It means the opportunity to bring decisiveness where there was uncertainty and confusion. And in the last 6 weeks, we've made a number of serious decisions. We want to deal with this, Richard, by making decisions about our banks, by making decisions about our employment situation, and by rectifying our public finances and restoring them to good health. This was started in fairness by the previous government. There's $6 billion being taken out of our economy this year. We're in an austerity programme. We didn't ask to be in there. But our economy's been staggering for a while. We want it to be able to stand upright, to pay its way, to play its part, and meet our targets and our demands. The fact that our own national debt was quite considerable and challenging has been exacerbated by the nature of the blanket guarantee given by the previous government. So you've got bank debt became national debt, and these two together impose a serious challenge for us.
For instance, was the decision that your predecessors made mm-hmm. to give a national backing of all bank debt, was that clearly just a strategic error of the first order?
Well, I always took the view. I also the view that this was a mistake. Obviously, we don't actually know the full detail of what happened here, and given the nature of our parliament, we can't find out without a referendum of the people to give the Oireachtas or the parliament the opportunity to have real inquisitorial powers, as it were, on matters of fact as against any intention of criminal intent. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have a referendum on that question later on in the year, so that parliamentary committees will be able to have compulsory powers of attendance for bankers and politicians and anybody else associated with that to actually attend before those committees, many in the same way as you do here with hearings in the States. But in any event, the Exchequer figures released yesterday show, for instance, that while many commentators would say Ireland's not going to be able to meet its targets, we're actually running $600 million ahead of targets on the main areas of tax like VAT or excise, corporation tax and income tax, which, if you like, is a sign of some small confidence that we're beginning to head in the right direction here. I think that comes from a feeling of goodwill for the new government, a feeling of people now understanding that having gone through the most serious stress test for our banks of any European bank system, we now know the scale and the reality and the truth of where that actually is, so you can deal with it. There are a number of banks that were not subject to those stress tests, and claims may or may not come in for further recapitalisation there. So we're dealing with that. We've made decisions about the number of banks we're going to have in the country, two pillar banks instead of six dysfunctional ones, continuing that with new requirements for the governance of banks, dealing with the bonus culture in the context of European directives, and seeing that this cannot happen again, where money was fired out left, right and centre to a prolific degree, which meant that banks knew they were lending money that they'd never be paid back, and people were borrowing money that they knew they couldn't pay back. And all came together. Then we want to deal with our unemployment situation. It's over 14% at the moment. And while there's been a slight drop in the last month, it's nothing like what we want to get to. And the reason, Richard, that we have to have jobs initiative next week is to deal with the lack of confidence in our indigenous economy. We've had increases in interest rates, increases in the cost of fuel, cost of energy. You've had a $24 billion requirement to deal with banks instead of an estimated $10 billion. And then you've had a very high savings ratio because people were afraid to spend money because of uncertainty, and therefore consumer demand fell, and therefore a lack of confidence. Yet our exports, with many multinationals from the States there, are running very strongly. 21 months, very strong surplus, and projections are very good. And even in my deliberations here yesterday and this morning, great enthusiasm, great excitement, great interest in investing in Ireland, because we've got very strong financial packages for business that will stand the test of time, including the clarity and the transparency and the certainty of the 12.5% corporation tax rate, which is a big issue for American business to invest in Ireland, foreign direct investment. That's been a cornerstone of that, as you know, for many years. And we're not shifting off that, despite the pressures that there might be from some of our European colleagues. I've made that perfectly clear on every radio and television station I've been speaking to. And the third element, then, is to deal with the budget deficit at home. And that's about $18 billion at the moment. So what we've initiated, we split the Department of Finance into two departments. One to deal with the bigger picture, the other to deal with public expenditure and public sector reform. We have an agreement between the labour unions and the management and the government to reduce the numbers in the public sector by 25,000 by voluntary redundancy and redeployment over the next number of years. We've implemented a range of austerity programmes, pension levies, public pay reductions, cutbacks in one sort or another, that will lead us to a point where we can close this deficit to manageable proportions and hope that we can build on further growth in exports, confidence in our indigenous economy, and get on with meeting our targets. It's not going to be easy. Our people know this, but they also have a willingness to get through this this valley of obstacles, if you like, and come out the far side as a leaner, more efficient, more professional country to deliver the public services. And my political philosophy is that by 2016, and the centenary of the year when those who took the first stumbling steps towards economic independence and political independence, that we will demonstrate we're the best small country in the world in which to do business. And speaking today down on Wall Street, down on the New York Stock Exchange, in meeting with a number of potential investors, they are actually very excited about the clarity and the decisiveness and the stability that the new government can bring to the country and its reputation. And partly the reason why I'm here and here today, thank you for your invitation, is to help rebuild that reputation and have that connectivity that's always been strong between our two countries. And that's going to be very heavily endorsed by the visit of President Obama when he comes in the next few weeks. And he and his First Lady will be made more than welcome in Ireland as he heads to Britain and on to France.
Let me ask one more question, and I'll open up to our members. As you look forward, do you think there's any chance that you'll be forced to restructure your sovereign debt, or do you think you can escape that?
I think we can deal with this. The indications yesterday on the Exchequer returns, even at this stage, are a measure of confidence. Obviously, you'd like to be in a much stronger position. But that's the opportunity of politics. The scale of the challenge is enormous, but so is the opportunity to get it right. And people in times of pressure and austerity are willing to accept change, and change is very necessary in the way we do business and have been doing business, and that's my mandate. We've set out a really strong programme for government with our partners in government, the Labour Party, and we intend to deliver on that, and that's our political priority. Our people demand and deserve no less. That's why they voted. That's why I sit here as the leader and Taoiseach of the country. And I can't say it any more strongly than to say I intend to demonstrate the proof of that mandate by delivering on that programme. And I believe that it has the potential to turn around the fortunes of our people and our country, and give an opportunity for that creativity and ingenuity and energy that is in our young generation, who, in my belief, can stand on the competitive stage with their peers in any country around the world. It's just to harness all that together. And when you land in government, for those of you who might land in government, it really comes at you like one of those unfortunate tornadoes down in Louisiana or wherever. And you've got to be able to face that head on and deal with it. People want integrity, they want decency, they want truth, they want decisiveness, they want hard work, and they need you to lead that by demonstration and by example. And that's what I intend to do with my cabinet for the period they leave me this remit with.
And that also, does that mean that the bondholders ought to be protected against any sort of haircut?
When we discussed the question of the decision that we're making about the pillar banks, Richard, we discussed this with the ECB, actually Ryan Jean-Claude Trichet and myself when he was in China, and they were very strongly of the view that we should not burn senior bondholders in Allied Irish Bank or Bank of Ireland, which are going to be our two pillar banks. Remember, Europe continues to say no until no becomes yes. Because Europe always said you can't burn subordinated bondholders either. And now they've been making a significant contribution. But I put it this way to you. The stress tests that were carried out were exceptionally strong and are overcompensated, if you like, because the decision that the government made to have two core banks means that you split them into core and non-core. That allows for the deleveraging of the non-core elements, which will provide credit capital for lending to business, which will stimulate the economy, have a leaner, more efficient machine. But also, Anglo-Irish Bank, which name was taken down from the bank last week as an iconic symbol of change and movement forward, was not subject to those stress tests. And their senior bondholders, which are not very many in extent now, are in a different category than senior bondholders in AIB or Bank of Ireland. And if a requirement for further capitalisation of Anglo-Irish Bank comes before us, then the government would deal with that, obviously, in a different light than we did with senior bondholders in Allied Irish Bank or Bank of Ireland.
Message received. Okay, with that, let us know if you'd like to ask a question. Please wait for a microphone. Give us your name. And there's a young lady all the way in the back. I will do that. And by the way, keep your questions short and one to a customer.
Thank you for calling me young lady as well. I really appreciate that. My name is Pauline Hines, and I work for Thomson Reuters. I'm an Irish citizen. I'm from Tipperary. I do have one question for Taoiseach. However, it's a multidimensional question, so I'm going to try and shorten it.
Why don't we stick to one dimension?
I will try. I understand that you're here to try and repair and rebuild Ireland's reputation as a centre for foreign investment, and I think that's really important. It's something that our country needs very badly. I do think, however, you know, as I read the news at home and I talk to people at home, we struggle. I'm sorry, Mr. Haass, but it has to be multidimensional. And I would like to just briefly touch on these points, Taoiseach.
Actually, you can't do that. You've really got to get to the question. We've got a lot of people who want to ask.
Okay.
Sorry, one question.
Infrastructure and services are key at home, and they're sadly lacking. Health, education, community services, all are being torn apart. And I think that that's really important. If you want to bring foreign investment and you want to bring people to work in the country, they have to have those basics, and they don't really exist today. I haven't really seen a clear plan from the government.
You've got to ask a question.
That's my question is, what is the government's plan to deal with the education scandals, the health scandals, and the desire to centralise community services like schools, post offices, hospitals? I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Well, let's start with the health system. We're spending $20 billion on health at the moment. And it is true to say that the current structure of the health system has not delivered first-class health services to all our citizens in the way that you would want. For those who get inside the system, they find the best nurses and doctors you'll find anywhere, who do heroic duty with a lot of pressure. So what we're doing now with the health system is to change it over the period of government and bring in what we call the Dutch health model system, which eliminates the two-tier system that applies in Ireland, which will eliminate waiting lists, which will bring about a situation where money will follow the patient and hospitals get paid for what they do, instead of a system of having hospitals paid at the beginning of the year and no account afterwards of how that money is spent, so that when they run out of money by June or July, wards close down, expensive equipment lies idle, people get onto long waiting lists and so on. This is a complex area. So the Minister for Health, himself a man of considerable medical experience, is already setting out on dealing with those fundamental changes. There's an acceptance and a willingness that this happen, but it can't be done overnight. It's going to take that programme for government to bring about that evolution. In respect of education, our system in general measures up much better than many others, but it can be improved and it will be improved. We've got to look at the question of the use of our universities and colleges of technologies. There's always a sense of, you know, that ours is the best in the world. We're a small country, and I think we can get better use from our universities by cooperating together with business and the colleges of technology to a greater extent in the interests of foreign direct investment, whether it be in the pharma area or the medical area or the financial services or whatever. But there's always the issue of population drift and demography. Planning permissions are not an easy thing to get either in Tipperary or anywhere else, as you're probably well aware. Population numbers have declined in terms of family numbers, so this has implications for school sizes. We had an influx of a huge number of people from other Eastern European countries during what were known as the Celtic Tiger years. Many of those have now left and gone back to their own countries because work wasn't available in the way that it was previously. So these are issues for government. It's fair to say that during that 10-year period, a very significant amount of monies were spent on the provision of motorways, which now go from Belfast to Dublin, from Dublin to Cork, from Dublin to Galway and other parts of the country. There were significant improvements in the rail system. There is the basis of a very good broadband system being finalised and put in place. Obviously, we're looking at renewable energy in terms of wind production and renewables from wave and tidal. Serious amounts of capital lining up to be invested there, and that's the challenge of the future. So I wouldn't be as pessimistic as you are yourself. Community spirit is actually very strong in the country, and despite the fact that many people have had a loss of income and a loss of lifestyle, if you like, the sense of community has actually grown stronger, and many organisations have come together in a very real way, which is deep within the nature of Irish people. Having had to deal with emigration issues over 2.5 centuries, we know what that's about. So for me, I'm an optimist by nature, and what people need is leadership, and they need certainty on the way forward, and it's my duty and responsibility to give them that.
Are there any one-dimensional questions, Lucy? Lucy, kind of microphone there.
Thank you. My name is Lucy Commissar. I'm a journalist. Ireland invites companies such as Google and Microsoft to move their intellectual property created in the U.S. offshore to Ireland to evade U.S. taxes. Do you think this is a moral way to build your economy?
No, we don't. We don't invite anybody to evade taxes. We have a national competence in our tax structure, as other countries have. That's defined and set out in the Lisbon Treaty of the European Union. Our corporate tax rate is 12.5%. It's transparent. It's an effective rate of 11.9%. We don't obviously force companies to go to the country. Some European countries have a zero rate of corporate tax. Others have over 30% rate. But the effective rate may not be what the stated rate actually is. I think companies don't actually go to an individual country just because of a tax rate. Yes, it is an important element in the toolkit, as it were. But there are other elements that are required, such as political certainty, such as tradition. And in the case of Ireland, we have over 30 years, 40 years of investment from other countries, including the United States, as being the gateway to the European Union, which, as you know, has grown from 15 countries to 27 with a market of 500 million people. We have a very strong, proven legal base. We don't have any language problems insofar as American investment is concerned. And these are all complementary issues that need to be decided on by investors before they decide to go there. But beyond all of that, There is the people, because it's not just about economics or statistics. It is about the environment in which the work actually takes place, the kind of cities that we offer people, the kind of education system in which they and their children can participate in. And these elements are also part of the makeup of decisions for investors in the first place. And on top of that, when you speak to them and you ask them, are you happy with the quality of the graduates emerging from third level colleges to work in the firms that you produce? By and large, they are. And flexibility from a small country allows you to actually change curriculum to cater for the standard that's required by individual companies. So as a small country, we have that opportunity and hope we measure up in respect of their needs. So it's not a case in any way of inviting people to evade tax. Ireland is not a tax haven for people who evade tax. We've been very clear on that. Our standards are high in that regard, and will continue to be so.
Good answer. Professor Stieglitz. Joyce, if you get a microphone coming, even though we know you can project in a classroom.
Okay. You've inherited a large number of problems from your previous government. I just want to comment on two of them. One of them is the approach to restructuring the banks, the NAMA. The design of it was probably one of the worst in the world, and both in terms of effectiveness and also in terms of transparency, been widely criticized. Are you planning to wind it down, or what are you planning to do about it? And the second problem is austerity. We know what happens in general with austerity. The countries tend to go down. Your GDP has gone down. Unemployment goes up. So the question is, you may not have much fiscal space, but within that, how are you going to change tax structures and expenditure programs to stimulate the economy, given that the constraints that you have?
Well, I'll take the latter point first. Next Tuesday, the Minister for Finance will deliver on a government commitment to introduce a jobs initiative. We'd much prefer to be able to, as it were, spend money on a whole range of schemes, which we can't, because you are constrained by the requirement of responding to the Troika on a regular basis in respect of the IMF-EU deal. But what we are going to do is this. Before the general election, the individual parties spoke to the Troika and made it clear that we would have a different view from the memorandum of understanding that was drafted between the Troika and the previous government. And the IMF in particular said this: if you come forward with a stronger and more aggressive job creation program, if you come forward with a series of proposals for a leaner, more efficient public sector, public service area, we would be very interested in hearing what it is that you propose to do. And they informed us that they'd be willing to consider that on a case-by-case basis. So from the memorandum of understanding drafted with the original government, we've already introduced changes. We want to reverse the minimum wage cut, which was introduced by the previous government, for the reason that it only affects less than 2% of our workforce, and you don't want to race to the bottom in terms of wages. But the quid pro quo for that is an adjustment in fixed rates of employment for weekends that have been there for very many years, and an adjustment in the way we look at the structures that affect employment, like PRSI, like VAT, and we're going to reduce those, pay for them by a levy on the pensions industry, which has already been agreed. So our jobs initiative, if you like, is not a normal conventional full-year budget. It's designed deliberately to provide an injection and a stimulus to the indigenous economy, where that confidence that I spoke of earlier can be realised, and that people who have serious savings put away will begin to understand that they should be able to spend in a plan. We're also going to introduce a partial loan guarantee scheme. One of the biggest problems in our country has been that small business, particularly those who are involved in the manufacturing and the export business, have not been able to get credit from banks. Their overdrafts have been cut, no credit allowed, employment dries up, and the thing just goes on into a black hole. So what we're going to do is introduce a partial loan guarantee scheme there to give greater flexibility to banks to allow that to happen. So we hope that that's going to provide an indigenous stimulation to the indigenous economy, which could be very good. I don't say that it's going to, by any means, end all of our unemployment problem, but it's going to provide what we said it would, which is a local stimulus. In respect of the banks restructuring, well, I mean, we had all these reports commissioned one after the other about what happened, what didn't happen, and where we were. The end result was complete confusion, complete frustration, complete uncertainty. So the government made a decision to end all of that and to put in place two pillar banks. And as I said, have them split their business into core and non-core, allow for deleveraging of that, which will provide credit for access to business, and that plus the partial guarantee scheme should bring that about. So that's in place. We're not going to tolerate a situation where you had all of these obscene bonuses paid to bankers.
Person. Be careful in this room.
I understand that. So in our country, I make no apology for saying it. One person received a salary of over $3 million and walked away from it last November and was paid that, despite the fact that the bank itself had record losses. I know this is applied in the United States, where bankers have seen the insides of prison in some cases and have served sentences. In our country, nobody's gone to jail. One or two have been called in for questioning by the fraud squad or by the police authorities, but nobody's been penalised, as it were. And the public demand for some retribution for taking away salaries and the reduction of salaries, not for one generation but for a generation and a half, is very sore indeed when you understand that on the basis of reckless lending exceptional bonuses were paid out in our country, and I'm not talking about anything that might have happened in the United States. So we've made that decision. The governance of banks for the future will be very different. The European Union has responded by putting in place a directive saying that bonuses can't be paid either unless the deal is reviewed after 5 years and has actually worked. So it's not a case of the more you lend, the more you get immediately. There'll be conditions put in there. And we hope that that certainty, having come through those stress tests, will provide the basis for future growth and future expansion. And that's where we're going to make it work. We have to. We have no option.
Mr. Debevoise.
Would you do the words from the reporter? There seems to be some debate in Europe at the moment about whether countries should be permitted to restructure their debt. Your minister has a seat at ECOFIN. Are you concerned about contagion if Greece were allowed to restructure, for example? How will you instruct your minister?
Well, there were attempts to kind of lump all countries together who ran into difficulties. The circumstances are different in each case. In the case of Greece, Ireland and Portugal, you can't actually say that they're similar. There were different reasons why difficulties occurred. We're actually in a different position than either of the other two countries, because we've got a very, very strong structural base. We've got, you know, 100 of the world's best companies situated in Ireland, exporting very strongly. The situation here was that a measure of incompetence, of lack of regulation, of gross overlending and overspending, with no assessment of how public monies were being spent, higher wage packages, led to all of this coming together. Now, I was at the meeting in Brussels where the heads of government met, and obviously Prime Minister Papandreou from Greece was looking for a reduction in his interest rate and a longer extension of period of repayment. And while he wasn't in a bailout deal in the context of the IMF EU, an interest rate reduction was given to him. It was agreed at that meeting, in principle, by the heads of government, that countries in the bailout package could have an interest rate reduction applied to them. Ireland would look for such an interest rate reduction and is looking for it. It wasn't concluded at that meeting. Some countries were looking for conditions to be attached to it about changes in corporate tax rate, which I wasn't prepared to agree to. But because the stress test had not been finished on our banks, it was decided to let the Ministers for Finance continue the negotiations on that, and that's what's happening. Since then, Portugal's now come in, 78 billion, and their problems are different than Ireland. Their economy in many ways doesn't compare with its capacity and potential in the way that ours does. But be that as it may, the detail of the Portuguese bailout are not known to me yet, but that has to receive unanimous agreement at the meeting of the 16th and 17th of May. We want to meet our targets, we want to pay our way, we want to play our part, we want to continue to be central to the European process as we've always been. And despite the fact that some people would say, well, Europe's going to collapse, the euro's going to be no more, that's not the case. Germany and France and the other countries will see to it that that won't happen. And I'd make this point to you because your question is a valid one. In a political sense, Europe has responded very well to the requirements of the political European Union. The big countries worked with the smaller countries. An agreement was reached by various methods, either referendum or parliamentary majority or whatever, to agree on a series of referenda and treaties. The Lisbon Treaty, which is the latest one, gives the opportunity for the Union, the Commission, the Council and the Parliament to really achieve the very highest level of performance. In fact, 12 or 14 years ago, Europe intended to compete against the United States in terms of manufacturing and all of job creation schemes and all the rest of it. But it didn't measure up because it was too broad an agenda and national interest came first. But just as the political end of things has worked pretty well, there's a need for a focus on the monetary and economic development of the European Union. And one of the difficulties that you have with a 27-member union is that as elections occur at different times in the different countries, prime ministers can have a different view. For instance, in Finland, you might have a situation where they would have to say on the run into an election, you can't give any country in difficulties any concessions, whereas that might be to play off, you know, a party competing for votes in a national sense against a party in government. I serve as a vice president of the European People's Party, which is the largest voting bloc in the European Parliament, and from which come the President of the Council, the President of the Parliament, and the President of the Commission. So it's a large voting bloc comprising parties from across those countries. And I do see a need for the politics of Europe to address in a more effective way the economic plans and the plans for the economic expansion of the Union in the same way as happened in terms of the policy for the politics of the Union. And that's something that I think the leaders have got to work at in the time ahead.
We could go on, but we're not. Prime Minister has another commitment at approximately starting now. I want to thank him for taking time out of his schedule here in this visit to the United States to come here. We obviously look forward to the footage of the President when he comes to Ireland in a couple of weeks. Thank you all for being with us here today.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.